the book of Matthew, chapter 20. Chapter 20, and we're going to read from verse 1. And the parable tonight is the parable of the workers in the vineyard. And as per usual, we're going to start with a warm-up question that will help you get thinking. Those of you that are at home and online, the warm-up question is an integral part of a group Bible study. So here's the warm-up question. Who was your best boss, employer, or teacher? What made him the best, in your opinion? Give you a few minutes to think on that. Best employer, boss, teacher, etc. What was it about him that made him or her good? Found the passage for tonight, Matthew 20. Matthew 20, and I'm going to read from verse 1. We're talking tonight about the parable of the workers in the vineyard. Matthew 20, verse 1. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and sent them into his vineyard. About 9 in the morning, he went out and saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing. He told them, "You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. He went out again about noon and about 3 in the afternoon and did the same thing. About 5 in the afternoon, he went out and found still others standing around. And he asked them, "Why have you been standing here all day long doing nothing?" "Because no one has hired us," they answered. He said to them, "You also go and work in my vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and going on to the first." The workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came and each received a denarius. So when those came who were hired first, they expected to receive more. But each one of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. "These who were hired last worked only 1 hour," they said, "and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day." But he answered one of them, "I am not being unfair to you, friend. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last." I want to talk first of all about the landowner's passion for his harvest. My boss when I was younger was my dad, my father. I worked as a commercial fisherman. My father was a commercial fisherman. His father was a commercial fisherman. And as far back as I know, I come from a long line of fishermen. Excuse the pun. Long line is a method of fishing. But we were trawlermen, and my dad, he loved his work, and it showed. 2:30, 6 days a week, I had to be up, and I had to be down the quay alongside the quay, waiting for him so that we were to sail. I had my own house, Had my own house, had my own boat at one time as well. A car, motorbike, I had everything really. And all down to this prosperous job that I had, my father was very good at catching souls. Dover souls were his fish that he was always after. And I was up at 2:30 to sail at 3:00, and we would work till 5:00 at night when I would finally get alongside the quay, we'd land the fish, and then finally I could go back home and get something to eat and go to bed about 9:00. It was not a life. So every now and again, my dad would let me just take off. He was very gracious to me. He was a good boss. And he knew that I was a young man. I didn't want to work the way he worked. So he let me travel, and I traveled while working with him. I traveled to 5 different continents, and he knew that there was something that was that I was longing for, something that I was missing. And at times I would say to him, Dad, why don't we just take the day off? Why don't we just slow down in life and enjoy some time off? Why work so hard? What's the point? We already had more money than we could spend. It was fantastic, the amount of money that we were making. My father, though, had a passion for the sea and catching fish. He just had to catch as many as possible. This parable reminds me of my dad. This parable is about a landowner that had a passion for getting his harvest in. The parable is about a landowner who is the picture of the Lord of all creation, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He has to get in his harvest. You see, there was a time factor when it came to the harvesting of grapes. In the land of Israel, the harvesting time was just before Sukkot, which is the Feast of Tabernacles, which falls between September and October. And around that time, October time, and of course it's in our calendar, it's September and October, they go by a different calendar, they go by a lunar calendar, which has a 360 days in a year. And so their calendar moves around compared to ours, but it usually falls between September and October. So you have to be really careful when I'm planning my trips to Israel that I don't go there at the Feast of Tabernacles, because Jerusalem is just too many people. And then I also have to do it so that we avoid the rains. Well, this landowner, he had to get his harvest in before the rains fell in the October season, October, early November. And a lot of rain coming early before the grapes were harvested could dilute the flavor of the grapes, as well as cause the grapes to crack the skins, and microorganisms would propagate and rot the fruit of the vine. So this landowner decides the time and the fruit is ripe. I must get the grapes in before the rains start to fall. Notice that the landowner did not leave the enlisting of the workers in his harvest to a servant. He was the one himself that was up early in the morning, and he went down to the labor market. The middle of a town was usually the marketplace, and workers would gather at the crack of dawn to find work with someone that needed them. So he cares about his harvest. Now, a little bit about the day. The day was calculated into 12 hours, beginning with sun up being 6 a.m. in the morning. Sundown was 6 p.m. in the evening. So there were 12 hours as the sun got up, as it got to a zenith. That was 12 o'clock. So they had sundials. The hours were calculated differently, and obviously in the winter, the hours were shorter because, because of obvious reasons. There was less sunlight during the winter. So the 11th hour was 5 p.m. in the afternoon, and the 9th hour being 3 p.m. in the afternoon. Now, if a person in that day did not have their own land or was not attached to a family in that they were a slave or an employee for that family, then they were on their own and they were common daily laborers. And the common laborers that had little skills and not attached to a family would appear at the city market where they hoped that an employer would stop by and employ them. Those that had no skills but were harvesters were the lowest class of laborers, because if they didn't work that day, guess what? Their families didn't eat that day. God had stipulated to Moses that a hired day worker was to be paid at the end of the day. The Bible says, Leviticus 19:13, it says this: "Do not defraud or rob your neighbor. Do not hold back the wages of a hired worker overnight." God cares for such small things as labor relations. Isn't that awesome of our God? Now, a little bit about the denarius. At the time of Jesus, the wage of a Roman foot soldier was a denarius. So for a common hired day laborer to be offered a wage of a denarius, it was good pay. They immediately, these individuals that were there in the market, they immediately signed up and said, "I'll go for work for a denarius." A denarius, though, was a small amount of money, so meager that it just provided for a family the food for a day. Those that were grape pickers and harvesters were on the lowest rungs of the financial ladder in that day. Those that were hired later had not missed work opportunities because they were lazy and didn't get up in the morning. No. They were there because no one had employed them at the break of day. These men were still waiting at the labor exchange market because they were desperate and needing to care for their families. This landowner was compassionate for their needs due to their desperation by still being there later in the day. It is possible that the landowner did not tell them how much he would pay. Notice that, did you? That it's 9 o'clock in the morning. He didn't tell them that he was going to pay for the rest of the day. Those that were hired at 9, those that were hired at 12, those that were hired at 3, and those that were hired at 5. He didn't tell them how much he would pay them. He just told them whatever is right. Why? I began to think about that. Why didn't he tell them? And I think it's possible that he didn't tell them how much he was going to pay them, although already in his heart he knew what he was going to pay them. But he didn't want to tell them because those that were already there in the grape fields would have said, "How much is he going to pay you? How much do you agree on? You're later. We've already done 3 hours of work." And they would have, if he'd have told them, "Well, he's going to pay me a denarius," then those that started at 6 was, "Puh, well, that's not fair." And they would have started to do less work. So no, landowner is wiser than that. He kept his grace-filled heart for later to shower his grace on them. Now, this parable tells us about the landowner, God himself. It reminds us that God, first of all, seeks us. He seeks us out in the slave market of sin, where we have been sold into slavery by Satan. Satan has his grips on us, and the Lord Jesus seeks, and he's come to save that which was lost. So he's come to the slave market of sin and bought every one of us that are Christians. He's paid the price for everyone in the whole world, but not everyone in the world will say yes to the landowner. Yes, our God cares greatly about his harvest, and he longs that all those who are saved would go to work in his fields. Workers are greatly needed. The Bible says in Luke 10, verse 2, you don't need to turn to it, it says this, he told them, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to thrust out workers into his harvest field. The word send is a push, a thrust. God wants so bad to get workers out into the fields. Why? Because everyone is so valuable to him. He cares about his harvest. He has a passion for catching souls, just like my dad. He had to be. His business was winning the lost. And he, this landowner, was ready to do whatever it takes, no matter how much it costs. He wants laborers to win the lost. He wants laborers to pick the vines. He cares eternally for every one of us. He does not want any to perish, 2 Peter 3, verse 9. But he wants that all would come to repentance. It's not just believing, although that's part of it, but to repent, to turn around their lives and walk with the Lord Jesus. We must labor in any way we are able to help bring in the harvest. Eternal lives are at stake in this endeavor. His heart is toward his people, and his nature is one of love and compassion. Here's what the Bible says about the nature of our God. In Psalm 145, verse 8 to 9, it says this, the Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made. Isn't that beautiful? I love that about our God, that he cares for every one of us. Now, we'll miss so much if we don't look at the context in trying to understand what this parable is all about. So I want to talk about the context of the parable. And to do that, I need to go to the preceding chapter, chapter 19. As we have said before, the chapter divisions and the verse numbers were put in at a later date and were not part of the original text. The parable of the workers in the vineyard in chapter 20 carries on Jesus' discussion with Peter in chapter 19. After Peter's shock, when Jesus was very easy with the rich, well, when he was very hard, in fact, on the rich young ruler, and he told him to sell all that he had and come follow him. Now, we haven't got the time to go into an exposition of that passage, but let's just read it, first of all. Chapter 19, verse 21. Jesus answered to the rich young man, if you want to be perfect, go sell your possessions and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. When the young man heard this, he went away sad because he had great wealth. Then Jesus said to his disciples, truly I tell you, it is hard for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. When the disciples heard this, they were greatly astonished and asked, who then can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, with man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. And here's the crux. Peter answered him, "We have left everything to follow you. What then will there be for us?" He has a way of putting his foot in it occasionally, doesn't he? And Jesus shares this parable that we're studying tonight just to kind of illustrate to Peter that is not the right heart attitude of a disciple. Let's carry on reading. Verse 28, Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you," I love his encouragement at what Peter said. "Truly I tell you, at the renewal of all things," which is still ahead for us, "when the Son of Man sits on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or fields for my sake will receive 100 times as much and will inherit eternal life." Notice verse 3, because we've already read that at the end of the parable in chapter 20. So this is what it turns on, verse 30 of chapter 19. "But many who are first will be last, and many who are last will be first." Notice Peter's thoughts in verse 27. Behind his words is there's the thought of self-serving and that attitude of, what's in it for me? Why should I do this? And Jesus states that there will be great rewards for those who have followed him in this life. But the Lord goes on to say that those who are first will be last, and many who are last will be first. So the parable makes the same statement at the end of our passage, our parable in chapter 20. So let me ask you a question so I can take a break. How does Jesus reassure Peter in Matthew 19, 28 to 29? Why is it dangerous for us to compare ourselves to one another? Why is it dangerous for us to compare ourselves to one another? Give you a few minutes to ponder that. So now we would, I'd like to talk with you about the interpretation of the parable. I kind of think that you'd like, how do we interpret this parable? Well, the landowner represents God. The laborers are the Lord's servants, those who have entered into covenant relationship with God or Christ. The vineyard represents God's kingdom, the sphere of God's rule and reign. The day of work is their lifetime. The end of day, when the servant of the landowner is sent to pay the contracted servants, is a picture of the coming of Christ at the end of the age and the beginning of eternity. Where he has said, Revelation 22, verse 12 says this, "Look, I am coming soon. My reward is with me, and I will give to each person according to what he has done." The contracted denarius payment that we will all get, those of us that are Christians, is what God has promised, the gift of eternal life. Now, the laborer that began at 6 o'clock in the morning, he failed to be thankful, and he was blind to the needs of others by his own self-interest and lack of compassion. So we must be careful of our attitudes as we serve the King of Kings. Some of us have entered into life in Christ at the dawn of day as young children. And some of you in this room and some of you at home have entered into relationship with God or with Christ when you were 3 years old or 4 years old, and I led both of my kids to Christ at a young, early age. And those of you that have entered into life at an early age, you spare yourselves the pain and the anguish and the guilt and all the rest of it that others of us that have come in at a later age incur. As for myself, I came to Christ at the age of 23 after being like a prodigal. Ah, sure, I didn't get in the pig pen, I didn't feed the pigs, but I was lost just as much as the prodigal son. And there came a drought on my soul, something that was drying me up within, that I knew I had to get this right with God. And that was what took me to five different continents. Something was missing with my very inner being. And it took a lot of grace after I came to Christ. I battled with my own soul. And sure, my soul was one with Christ when I gave my life to Christ. But all of a sudden, I'm battling against habits that I'd acquired because of my life without following Christ. And many of you have come to Christ later in your age and have got into sticky situations that have dragged you down and yet woken you up at the same time. I often envy those that were brought up in a Christian home with loving parents that corrected you and showed you the way of Christ, because I have found that in the earlier years of my Christian life, there was a lot of uprooting of weeds that had grown in the fertile soil of my heart and mind. The Bible says it is good for a man that he should bear the yoke in his youth. Lamentations 3:27 says. What does that mean? It's good to have some responsibilities and to get your life right with God when you are young. Some of you that have entered into life at an early age, you cannot remember the day when you were converted. And some of you envy those of us that were converted at a later age, like myself at 23. And I have had people say to me, well, you're a strong believer, and I envy that. Why hasn't there been such growth in my life? And for me, it was because I was so close to hell that when the Lord turned me around, when I knew that heavy weight of sin was off of me, the reality of the things of God was so brought so close to my soul. And some of you that come to Christ at a young 4, 5, 6 years of age, the 6 a.m. of the day, you look and say, well, I don't remember the day that I crossed. You remember the day and the hour, you remember the occasion, but I don't have that experience. And some of you can envy those of us that come later in the day. Well, I have a friend of mine that he was living in Holland. He's an English guy, and he was living in Holland, and one particular day he got on the train in Amsterdam, and he fell asleep on the train, not realizing, of course, he was just off to the suburbs where his apartment was, you know, a journey of about 10 miles, but he fell asleep and did not realize that his train crossed through the border of Holland all the way through Belgium and wound up in Paris before he finally woke up as the conductor came through the train and said, hey, you wake up, you're in Paris. Now, I use that analogy to say some of you don't remember the day you crossed the border. Some of you were that there's no distinct time when you remember that you crossed. You just know in your inner soul that you are now in the good land, the beautiful land. And you can't remember what it was, the day and the time, but you know that you know that you know you're in a different country. Are you with me? You know, the Bible puts it like this. Romans chapter 8, verse 16 says this: the Spirit witnesses with our spirit that we are the children of God. Now, what does that mean? What that means is in your inner being, in your spirit, in your knower, you know in your knower that you're a child of God. The Spirit of God witnesses with your inner spirit that you are right with God. You don't know when it was that you passed the border, but you know that now that you're one with Him. You own Jesus Christ and He owns you. There's no weight of sin in your life because at some point you crossed the border and you don't know when. Now, if you are at your senior year and you are wondering, well, I'm not sure that I've ever passed that border. Well, there's no better time than the present to say, Lord, I'm not sure, so tonight I want to be sure. And if that's your case, if the enemy is coming along and pointing the finger at you, then you can make sure by giving your life to Christ and repenting of sin and turning the direction of your life towards the Lord Jesus and asking Him to forgive your sin and to enter into your life. If that is your case, then there's no better time like the present. So some of you came to Christ at 6 a.m. in the morning. But be wary, though, those of you that have entered into life at that time of life, that you think that you should have more of the blessings of God upon you. This, I think, is the warning that the Lord was giving to Peter, that there will come others that will enter the kingdom of God at a later time in their life that will go way past Peter in effort, gifting, and anointing. And for Peter to not get his heart focused on what's in it for me, how come these people have got more of God than me? That is the wrong heart attitude, the Lord Jesus is saying. Men such as the Apostle Paul. You know, that the Bible talks about Peter up until chapter 9, when the Apostle Paul comes on the scene in the book of Acts. And from chapter 9 on, all you read about, you do hear about Peter, but only once or twice. And it's all about Paul, because he has a greater anointing, there's a greater presence of God in his life, and it's like he overtakes Peter. And Peter is to guard his spirit against those attitudes that are of this world, that are conflicting with the values of the kingdom. Most people come to Christ in their youth or teen years. And maybe this would be a picture of the 9 o'clock hour of the day in the parable. If you are in your teens, those of you that are watching this on the video or on the internet, if you're in your teens or early 20s, if you have not yet given your life to Christ, then why not? What's holding you back? The grace of God is offered to you free of charge, the denarius of eternal life that God gives to all men, no matter what stage of life that you are at. God offers this denarius, this contract, legal contract, where He has promised eternal life to everyone who believes. Are there bonds of sin that are already starting to set on your life as a young individual? Maybe you're wavering as to your final destination. So consider the claims of Christ on your life. Look at His death on the cross and believe, trust, on the Lord Jesus Christ, his promise to you is that he will give you the gift, and it is a gift. We cannot earn this gift. That's where the parable breaks down when you look at details like that. But determine that you'll receive it today, while you have today, that you may have everything to look forward to when you come to the senior years of your life. Now, let me ask you a question, give you a chance to think. At what stage of life were you called? Share with one another what difficulties you had with ungodly values and habits that seeped into your life at different stages. Give you a few minutes. Think about it and discuss. I want to talk with you now about it's never too late. It's never too late. The enemy will tell you that it's too late. Many of you that are hearing these words today on video and in this room have wondered. You are probably at 12 o'clock or at 3 p.m. stage of life, and you think, well, no one's ever going to come to the marketplace and employ me at this time of the day. Anyone would be crazy. The day is nearly gone. And who would want me at this stage of my life? Well, the God of heaven comes again and again to the marketplace, looking, seeking who will come and work in his vineyard. You've heard of the term middle age. In our society, people spend vast amounts of money trying to hold on to their youth. I'm in what's called the baby boomer generation. And the baby boomers, they hate the fact that we're getting old. We're not as young as we used to be. And that generation, and some of you here in this room and on the TV, are that generation that would so want to cling to our youth. And why is this? We tend to think that the best years of our lives are in our earlier years. And that is exactly what the media will tell us day in, day out. And the messages we see in the media reinforce this thought. George Bernard Shaw once said, "Youth is a wonderful thing. It's a shame to waste it on young people." How often have you thought, and myself, I wish I could go back in time with the knowledge that I have now acquired? Contrary to the world's thinking, though, is the fact that in God's kingdom, time is not a factor and age is not a factor. We are vitally important to the Lord at every age and at every stage of our lives. To God, our age is not relevant when he has a job for us to do. Maybe it has something with the fact that he dwells in eternity. He doesn't see time and age the same way we do. After all, what did God do in the life of Abraham? You think of Abraham and Moses. Moses thought that he was all washed up at 40 years of age when he ran from Egypt, and he spent 40 years in the wilderness. And at 80 years of age, then he was finally called. Why does God do that? At 80 years of age, couldn't you have called him at a younger age? Well, age has a way of teaching us some things. So those of us that are a baby boomer generation, these are the best years. Don't think of them as the worst years of your life. You have opportunity to serve in the landowner's fields and pick his grapes. I think that at even at 3 p.m., of the day, it is not too late to go into the vineyard and go to work harvesting the grapes. Your part is a part that no one else can play in this harvest. Think of that advertisement, which is always on the TV, and I think it's an Apple advertisement, but it says this, that the powerful play goes on and you may contribute a verse. Every one of us in this part, this theater, this life, this experience that we find ourselves in, we all get to play a part. And God can use every one of us to contribute a verse. God has a specific way that he wants to use you to glorify him. This landowner, our picture of God, has not given up on you. And it doesn't matter what stage of life you are in. He comes still looking for you at 5 p.m. stage of your life and says, I'm still looking for you. Will you come and labor in my vineyard? He comes into the marketplace. Why on earth does this landowner come at 5 p.m.? You know, who even would stand waiting there at 5 p.m., knowing that it's nearly 6 and the evening will be set in? But some men were waiting there, and some of you today find yourselves at the 5 p.m. stage of life where you have wondered, well, I am still not right with God. Has God passed me by? And maybe you've said that question. Has God passed me by? No! God has not passed you by. The Lord Jesus Christ would come at 5 p.m. of this stage of your life and says, come, come, work in my vineyard. And he wants to give you the same wage as the guy that started at 6 a.m., a denarius. Eternal life for every one of us. God has a specific way that he wants to use you to glorify him. There are those of you that have known a friend or a relative that came into the kingdom of God on their deathbed. While there is still time, there is opportunity. The thief on the cross gives us great encouragement because he didn't have any time. Yet Jesus said to him, this day shall you be with me in paradise, on the basis of turning to the Lord Jesus Christ while he is dying on a cross. While there is still life in this world, you can call upon this God and he will give you the denarius of eternal life, the gift of God. There is another layer to this story, another peeling of the onion, so to speak, another way that we can interpret this parable, in my humble estimation. The day can also be seen as the duration of time over the last 2,000 years, the church age day. And those that have come to Christ at the 6 a.m. stage, and we could talk about Paul the Apostle, we could talk about Stephen, we could talk about Philip, we could talk about Barnabas that we read about in the book of Acts. And then we could talk about those that came at 9 a.m. We could talk about John Calvin. We could talk about Martin Luther. We could talk about John Wycliffe and John Wesley and William Booth and William Wilberforce that came at the 12 p.m. and the 3 p.m. stages of life. Then there's Hudson Taylor, George Whitefield, and the list goes on and on to our present day. And we may be in the twilight years before the darkness sets in. And I believe that the shadows are already lengthening on the church age day when the Lord will come and the harvest will begin. But even at this stage of the church day, he is still looking for more workers to labor in the great harvest that is ahead. Do not think for a minute that one cannot do much work at this late stage of the church age. If a man such as Paul the Apostle, in my humble, I began to think of this, if Paul the Apostle was alive today, what would he use? I think that that man, full of passion and love for the Lord Jesus Christ, would use technology to its limits. He would be here, he would be there, he would use everything that was available to him to pick the fruit, to pick the harvest, to get into the fields and call as many home as he possibly could. I think of the Joshua Project statistics. Joshuaproject.org is a good website to go to see the statistics of where the harvest is at this present time. Did you know that there are 7.06 billion people on planet Earth? And of that amount, 2.94 billion people are as yet unreached. We got a lot of work to do, brothers and sisters. Jesus told us that he will not come until the earth had heard this message. So there's nearly half of the population of the earth are yet unreached. Most of these are in India, Southeast Asia, and the Middle East. And those of us in our senior years can be tempted to judge methods of reaching Christ, reaching others for Christ using technology, because it's just not like how we did it in our younger years. But methods must change with the means that are available to us. But I believe too that there is a greater level of the anointing, the power of God that rests on the church. There is a spirit of revelation that is on the church in our day as the church comes closer to the greatest revival, the greatest harvest of the before Jesus comes. There is a greater sense of the Spirit as the church is being trained and equipped. At one time, you had to go to grape picking school to pick grapes. Didn't you know that? You had to learn the manual of grape pickers. And you had to sit around and listen to the grape picker teacher so that you could learn how to pick the grapes one by one with great care. But then came what has been happening in Asia, in China, where several years ago, it was recorded that there was 100 million believers just in China alone. And China has 1.4 billion people. That's nearly a quarter of the world is Chinese. And what are we doing as the church to reach them? I believe that there is a greater sense, a greater anointing in this church day, this 5 p.m. of the church day, to pick the fruit. And we don't need to go to grape pickers school to learn how to pick the grapes. And what we've discovered, those of us that are pastors, is that God is using common people that are untrained that can, yes, reach out and pick a grape. It's not that hard to pick a grape. And he uses common people. And I put myself in that rating because he uses people, fishermen, simple fishermen that loves God and loves this book. And he uses people like me and you. So let me ask you another question. What did Jesus mean by his statement that many who are first will be last, and many who are last will be first? How does God's grace contrast with the values we see in our society today? So there's two parts, two questions. Let me read it again. What does Jesus mean by his statement that many who are first will be last? Because that seems to be the emphasis right at the end of chapter 19 and right at the end of the parable. Jesus is reiterating this statement. So what does he mean? And many who are last will be first. And then the second question, how does God's grace contrast with the values we see in our society today? I'll give you a few minutes. How do we interpret this statement? Many who are first will be last, and many who are last will be first. What on earth does that mean? I think that there will be some shocks and some surprises in that day when our Lord Jesus Christ comes and we are all gathered, all of us that are Christians are gathered before him. Because I think that there will be some that have had notoriety, and yet they will be behind us. And there'll be others at the front, and we'll be trying to see them, and we'll ask, who are they? I never heard of them. What's that guy doing up front? What did he do? With notoriety, there's fame and other lower things of this world. But there are laborers that are last that will be first. There are laborers that are at work in this vineyard of the landowner. And those individuals labor day in, day out with no notoriety and with little help from the rest of the church, but they have stuck to the task even though they have no notoriety, no publishing, no one knows their names, but they labor and get stuck in to picking the grapes. I kind of think that there are some of you in this room that labor, and those of you on the TV, that labor in what you are doing as unto the Lord only. And you have decided, Lord, I'm not going to care whether man will see what I do. But you see what I do, and my worship is to you. My labor is to you. I'm going to continue to labor in this vineyard. I'm going to continue on preparing meals for the saints. I'm going to continue and visiting the sick, and I'm going to continue on all kinds of things that man does not see, yet you see. There are many that are first that will be looking behind us, because they will be last, because their motives have all been wrong. Their motives have not been for the Lord Jesus himself. Their motives has been about what can I get out of this, like Peter's attitude there. The Lord had to correct that attitude and tell him, look, that is not the Christ-like attitude that should be in believers. We labor what we do, not caring about the reward. It's not about the reward. It's about love for Jesus Christ, and we do what we do because we love him. We don't do what we do to get the reward. The reward is just comes along out of love. We do what we do because we love Jesus, and he has loved us first. This landowner, his utmost thought, his passion is to bring in the harvest, and he will empower everyone that says, yes, Lord, I am willing to work in your vineyard, and I will do whatever I can do. Lord, come and enable me, help me. Lord, I don't have the grape picker's manual, but help me to just pick grapes. The joy of being part of bringing in the harvest is what will be common amongst all of us on that day. When we get together in that day, oh, there will be many high fives. Oh, there will be many hugs. Because we have all had a common task, and that is to glorify God and his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and to do what we can to touch the lives of others in the kingdom. I want to close with some thoughts from R.T. Kendall. R.T. was a protege of Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones and pastor of Westminster Chapel in London, England. Here are some of his thoughts on this parable, just to close. Quote, this parable calls for grace and justice. The workers were given the job. That is grace. They must have felt very fortunate, or they wouldn't have agreed to it. When God has given us work to do, we feel blessed. I am so blessed to be able to labor and teach you the word of God. I really do count it a blessing of God. It is a high honor to be chosen and to be given an anointing to work in God's vineyard. But they were not only given a job, they were also given justice. The workers who were hired about the 11th hour came and each received a denarius. When those came who were hired first, each one of them received a denarius. You may say, how is justice served when people come in at the 11th hour and get paid the same amount? This is the way in which God can be just and merciful at the same time. Justice means that we deserve to be punished. Mercy means that God doesn't want to punish us. And when Jesus died on the cross, his blood satisfied divine justice. So now God can save those who come in at the 11th hour just as quickly as those who have been converted for most of their lives. Finally, the workers are given a judgment. The landowner said, take your pay and go. If I want to give the same amount to somebody who has arrived in the last 5 minutes, I can do that. Don't I have a right to do what I want with my money? Isn't he a gracious God? That is judgment. God can do what he wants with each of us. Who are you, O man? Paul said in the book of Romans 9, verse 20-21. Who are you, O man, to talk back to God? Shall what is formed say to him who formed it, why did you make me like this? Does not the potter have the right to make out of the same lump of clay some pottery for noble purposes and some for common use? God says, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy. God can do what he wants with his fallen creation because his judgment is right. This parable is about the grace of God and how he sovereignly bestows it upon different people in different ways at different times. Ultimately, God decides. My duty and yours is to let God be God. Would you stand and let's pray? Lord, we desire to let you be God. And Father, we consider it such a joy to labor in your vineyard. And Father, for those tonight that have been lied to by the enemy and says it's just too late in your life, well, I pray that each one listening to this tape, this video, will know the truth that you love everyone with the equal amount, that your spirit rests upon us and your call is to each one of us. Father, I pray that everyone, even those that are in their 80s and 90s, may come to you tonight and may call upon you while there is still time. Turn to the Lord Jesus Christ, believe the gospel, and you shall be saved and receive the denarius of eternal life. We ask all of these things in the mighty name of Jesus.